Hi, Darlington Obasi from Health and Fitness Empire again. There is a big concept out there about focusing on our physical health, like having a great body and, you know, eating the right diet. But at the same time, I do believe that there is a concept that a lot of people aren't really like focusing on, which is mental health, especially fear and self-doubt. Like in this interview I had with Corey, she is an online yoga instructor and nurse, and she's going to be sharing with us like her life journey in overcoming fear to building the dream life she has always wanted. To me, I think it's a huge point that I've always wanted to like bring into the topics I talk about, to empower people more on the idea of not just focusing on your body, but also incorporating your mind into everything we do in life. Coming up next. Hi, Corey.
Hi.
Welcome to the show. Before we dive in, I want to quickly read out some key points based on the psychology of fear. In a medically reviewed article I found by Very Well Mind, fear is a very powerful human emotion and naturally alerts us to the presence of danger. Also in this article, The Psychology of Fear, there is something interesting that I love. Fear was divided into two responses. One is a biochemical reaction, which is universal in all human beings, like the fight or flight response. Mm-hmm. A typical example would be, let's say you find yourself in a bush and all of a sudden you see a lion. What happens? It's either you run away or you attack it. Pretty much that's a biochemical response, fight or flight. Then the other part that I'm so interested in is called the emotional response of fear, which is different in every human being. So many people have a fear of success, a fear of failure, a fear of rejection, loss, change, and also fear of the unknown, right? So, and these are like the types of fears that we have out there. There are so many other ways. Like some people fear so many things, like, can I be able to like pull off what I put my mind to? Because I know for myself, I struggled, and sometimes I still struggle with a fear of age, you know, like with fitness and, you know, going, you know, into what I believe in, you know, to the longest time period. So my first question now to you is, do you think that our experiences in life can sort of contribute to the fears we have?
Like, do you mean, do they help create the fears that we
yes.
have?
Yes, yeah.
Well, 100%, because you get conditioned. The experiences we have, so how you grow up, what you're taught, what you're not taught, mm-hmm. the things you see, that's all that you know.
Yeah.
So, of course, that's going to influence future fears that you have. So, if you're raised with no money and it's always a struggle and every decision is... every decision is really difficult and it's like scary, well, that's how you're going to face future decisions, because that's all that you know.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, I know for me, I've really struggled with like the belief in myself, because I come from a small town that like women weren't really doing much, and I was kind of raised that way, that we just fall in line. And so I always had bigger dreams, but getting myself to those dreams was really scary, because I didn't know what was really possible,
yeah.
essentially, right? I wasn't raised with that idea that you can do whatever you want to do. It's no, this is kind of where you're supposed to be.
Yeah.
So it was really the belief in myself, right? So that fear of well, that fear of what happens if I do actually do the things I want to do.
So it was like more of a change in mindset. Like, how did you get to that point? Like, based on the little story you shared right now, like growing in a small town and, you know, believing that women weren't really expected to like do much at some point, like, how did you shift that? Because I know also, because I'm from Nigeria, you know, like, to an extent there is a little belief like that as well, that women feel like they're not really empowered like so much. Like, how were you able to like shift, as in that mindset, to like chase your goals and believe that you can achieve them?
I wish I could say I think there's a magic formula, but I don't. I think at some point you have to decide that what you want is worth more than your fear. And if the worst thing that happens is that your fear comes true, can you live through that? 100% you can, always, right? Because our fears are usually things like, well, what if I succeed, or what if I fail, or what if someone looks at me funny, or, right? Those are our fears.
Exactly.
So if you just have to decide that, well, maybe what I want is worth going for, and what if those worst outcomes happen, I'll still be okay. And I had to tell myself that. I've had to tell myself that so many times, that I will still be okay. And then just start making decisions towards that. I think it's helpful sometimes if you make small decisions. So sometimes we think like, okay, I don't even know what an example would be, but your thing you want is over here and you're here. Well, make one small choice today to get you there.
Okay.
One thing. But that empowers you.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter who you are, man, woman, where you're from, that's very empowering. When you do one thing and you're like, oh, okay, that feels good. So it actually, so talking about biochemical responses,
yeah,
it changes the inside.
Yeah.
It aligns your cells and aligns your energy differently inside.
Okay. So to an extent, that's like the idea of, because the note I have here is like, do you think upbringing and our environment play a role in the way we react to fear? And you said yes, and I believe 100% too, because there are situations where you find yourself in and you're like, maybe if you've seen things a certain way for a very long time, you just feel like you can't make any difference. You know what I mean? Like, you just feel like it should be that way. But what about association, the people you hang around with?
So there's a few things. There's, yes, the way we're raised, houses we've lived in, all these things condition us. But condition does not equal causation, right?
Mm-hmm.
Conditioning just means that it's what you're used to.
Okay.
And so, yeah, it can be unconscious things. So I think a lot of what fear has to do with is, and this is why it's so hard for people, it's so hard for me, like, to stop and take a good look inside myself and go, am I doing this just because that's what I've seen for 30 years?
Mm-hmm.
Or is there another way?
Yeah.
And there's always another way. There's always another path. There's always another way to think. But just because it's unknown doesn't mean it's wrong. I think a lot of what we think is normal is the wrong thing, because it's just conditioning.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
It's not necessarily what you need to be thinking, doing, who you need to be loving, where you need to live, like all these things, right?
Yeah.
So, and that's where you can take conditioning into kind of into the positive and use it to your advantage, is by, as an adult, you get to choose who is in your inner circle. I think a lot of people think that it's everything's happenstance. So your friends are happenstance, your family's happenstance, where you live is happenstance. Like, you have no choice, and you have a lot of choice, right?
Yeah, I agree.
Just because people have been in your life for a long time doesn't mean they get to stay.
Yeah.
You get to choose because of that conditioning thing. If you choose people that you want to be like, you're using conditioning to your advantage, because
mm-hmm.
you're saying, I'm aware of how this works, that if I'm hanging out with these people all the time,
okay.
my mind is going to automatically think like these people, because that's just the way we work.
And that's the power of association, right?
So it's using it to your advantage and not just being like, oh, whatever, this is just the way it is.
Okay, let's kind of as in change as in the idea around a little bit. You're a yoga instructor, right? I am someone who believes so much in fitness. And there is this hype about physical health and fitness, healthy lifestyle. But the idea of mental health is huge. And a lot of people ignore that part and focus more on the physical aspect of it. Because I know there have been moments when I wake up and I know I can do well, but I don't have the energy to go to the gym. And that's where the idea of fear and self-doubt come in. You're always like, okay, can I really pull this off? You know, like I'm 30 something. I know personally that I struggle with that a lot. Like, how you being a yoga instructor and like you're super fit, I've seen some of your videos, like how do you manage to like keep yourself going all the time?
Because I work it backwards a little bit. For one, I don't think I have to do it. You don't have to do anything to be happy, to feel good. It's what you want. So I don't put that pressure on myself that I have to go to a certain amount of yoga classes or teach a certain amount of yoga classes or eat a certain way or do anything really to be happy. So I think the struggle comes in is when people rely on those things to be happy. Then you're going to get fears, you're going to get blocks, and you won't be able to get through them because you haven't figured out how do you want to feel. So when I first started shifting how I see myself, for whatever reason, I decided my word was radiant. I wanted to feel radiant. Like I wanted to feel like I was beaming and glistening and glowing.
Mm-hmm.
And so for 1 year, every single decision I made was focused around that. Everything I put in my mouth, exercise, everything. I said, will this make me feel radiant today? That simple. And if it did, if I thought it would, so sometimes that meant eat the cookies, right? Because I just felt like it would give me energy or whatever. And sometimes it was like, no, I think I'm going to do the salads today. I'm not oversimplifying it. I think it is that simple. It took out the extra stuff. It took out everybody else's crap. It took out my fears. It took everything out because it was that simple. And I still kind of make decisions based upon that. Like, is this going to serve me? And it takes out some of that fear stuff, because then it doesn't really matter. If I feel like it's going to serve me, ultimately it will. Even if, quote unquote, you fail, or even if you don't get there the timing you want, like for fitness goals or whatever, right? If you feel like it's going to serve you, make you happy somehow, then it probably is, right? In the grand scheme of things. So it kind of helped me drop some of those fears. So I think people, it's reworking it from the other end. It's key. What is this? So if you have a fitness goal, you're going to do a 12-week transformation thing, you're going to go to the gym all the time and eat a certain way. You're doing it because you want to feel a certain way.
Okay.
People don't think about it. So when they do this thing and say it doesn't get them there, they say, oh, it doesn't work. They're not happy still, right?
Mm-hmm.
I've been through that journey. I did lots of fitness competitions. And I felt worse in the end than I did when I started. You know, being super lean, coming on stage, I felt worse about myself. Even though to the world, it's like, holy cow, you lost all this weight and you're ripped and you're in a bikini and blah. It was because I hadn't changed inside. I didn't know how I wanted to feel. I thought that the external stuff would make me feel better, and it didn't, right? So if you don't know how you want to feel, you don't know where your end result is, you're going to let all those fears, misbeliefs or doubts or whatever get in your way because you don't know how to overcome them.
Yeah.
You don't have something drawing you, pulling you towards your goal.
Talking about beliefs, I do have a second point I was going to talk about. Like, there is this concept about limiting beliefs and behavior we've learned in the past that it makes people feel a certain way. So, like, with the idea of what you just said, do you think to an extent that, let's say the idea of weight loss, the idea of putting on muscle and things like that, do you think that most people feel like they can't really pull it off right from the word get-go because of something that happened in the past as a result of the belief system they had, you know, still tying it to that angle of experiences and upbringing?
Sometimes, yeah, the belief that you can't actually do it for sure is there, but I don't think that's usually the problem for most people, whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
There's other limiting beliefs that come into play. So I've seen this one in friends who are quite big and they want to lose weight quite a bit. It's not that they don't think they can do it. It's that, say you've heard a story your whole life growing up, like, you know, skinny people are mean or skinny people are selfish, or you hear some sort of story about being skinny. So they want to be skinny. They don't doubt that they can get there. But for 30 years, they heard from their parents this story about what skinny people are like. Why would you want to get skinny if you think that that's how people are going to talk to you? So you're blocking yourself because of a limiting belief, right? I've seen this play out in my life with trying to be very successful, you know, building a business, trying to make more money. And it means I have to be in the limelight. It means I have to let myself shine. Well,
is that scary a little bit?
There's a limiting belief like that I've had to work through, that I'm still working through, about women don't do stuff like that.
Okay.
Women are not allowed to shine, right? Women are not allowed to be a leader. Women are not allowed to make money. Like, all those things that I absorbed as a child. Well, of course. Well, then I would block myself from making money. I would block myself from being a leader, from being successful. Because if I think that that's... Women aren't allowed to do that, right?
Yeah.
So it's not necessarily about a fear of myself, but it's about a fear of all that other stuff that I've been hearing, so I have to clear it out, right?
So definitely experiences and our upbringing, it plays a big role in the way we respond to fear then.
The difference is once you recognize that it doesn't have to, that yes, those things are there and you have to deal with them, and sometimes that's really painful.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of fears in that in itself. It means, so maybe the way I have been doing things all my whole life isn't the only way. Maybe there's a better way for me, right? You have to be able to look at that, and that's scary in of itself.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. The concept of yoga itself revolves around the mind, right? Like, I know fitness, like, I work out, but once you tell people that, I do yoga, you know, the word yoga comes to people in a different way, like meditation, mindset. Like, do you think that kind of hasn't helped you in a way overcome fear compared to other ways people try to, like, push
themselves?
The way
yoga works is that it connects the mind, body, and spirit. That's why it's so powerful. So most of us exist either in our head or without our logical mind, existing just in our bodies and being emotional. But the power of yoga is that it teaches you how to connect all those pieces. That there is a mindset piece, there is a logical piece of knowing when to push through something and knowing when to back off. Of saying, or giving yourself that pep talk, like, I know you're tired, but maybe you should go to class today, right? Like, and so most fitness activities are very heavy on that piece of, it's all in your mind, but it's not. There's another piece about listening to your body, about feeling your body, about connecting those two, right?
Yeah.
So, and then there's the other piece of, like, who we are as just a human, right? That spiritual side. Whether you believe in anything or not, you cannot deny the fact that there's something that connects us as humans, that we all have shared human experiences. Like, we all have pain, we all have suffering and loss, but we all can experience happiness and joy.
Yeah.
So it teaches people about that as well. And how did yoga help me with my fears? Well, I started yoga because I was injured at work by a patient and I lost everything. So I lost my ability to walk, dress myself, get groceries, drive, lost my job, I lost all the gym and the fitness stuff, I lost everything that I thought my life was in one foul swoop. And it was maybe a year and a half after is when my chiropractor suggested I go. And so I started going to yoga and I literally would show up and just lay there on the mat. Couldn't do anything. While everybody else is like doing all their crazy stuff, I was just laying there. And something started shifting as I did that, because I told myself, I was like, damn it, like, you have to show up for yourself. I don't care how hard this is, you need to come to your mat. And I would go and I would just lay there. And I started to kind of feel the energy, and I listened to the instructor, and then I would talk to people after class, and something started to shift where I was like, okay. Because I used to be an all or nothing person, and I have that kind of drive in me, like,
yeah,
I gave it my all. But something started to shift where I was like, okay, slow it down a little bit. Can you do one thing today? And that has to be good enough. That's enough. And there also was this shift of realizing that me inside, without all the external stuff that I thought made me successful, that I thought made me Corey, that I thought made me a human, had nothing to do with it. It's an expression, maybe. But who I am as a person was good enough without all that stuff. I was still the same me, right?
Mm-hmm.
I was still the same me without all this stuff that I'd kind of built in my life, which isn't bad. It's not a bad thing.
Yeah.
But I had to come to this place where it was all taken away for me to realize that I was still worthy, an amazing human being. And once I realized that, then I think that's when everything started to shift. Because then I was okay with, yeah, one day I would do one pose, and then maybe another day I could do another pose, and then maybe the next class I just did the breathing stuff and worked on the breathing. And it was very empowering, because then I was like, I can do this.
And you were doing it for yourself.
And it's enough, and it's for myself. It's not for anybody else. I don't care what anybody else thinks about this. I don't care that I show up and I'm like, just kind of doing my own thing.
Yeah.
Because I also wanted to be in the energy. I mean, I could have done it at home, and I did eventually start a home practice, but for me, I needed that energy at first of everybody. So that's kind of why I teach yoga, is because I want to empower people. I want people to connect their minds with their bodies and really feel who they are as a human. Not what anybody else thinks they are.
About, yeah.
Because then you can overcome anything.
Yeah.
Because once you are in your power, and you're like, either you then it just becomes simply a question of, do I want to do this or do I don't?
Mm-hmm.
And not anything else. That's it. It has nothing to do with what your family thinks, has nothing to really do with what your friends think or your partner or anybody. It's, is this right or not? Right?
For you. As an individual.
Simplifies it completely.
Yeah.
Because you know within you, if you decide you want to do it, then you will. Or you'll try, and then maybe you decide halfway through that it's not the right thing, and then you change your mind, but that's okay.
So it's always the willingness to try at some point. That's the goal.
No, I think it's the belief in yourself, because you know who you are. And the understanding that the decision has nothing to do with kind of how you were raised. The decision has nothing to do with what anybody else thinks. It has to do with you now in this moment. That's it.
Okay. Just to get that point right, so it's more of living in the moment. Ignore the past, just focus on the moment. Let's just say everything has happened, but I have this moment. What can I do right now?
Yeah, because when I was first starting out, I couldn't imagine my future anymore. I mean, I couldn't walk, I couldn't do all the things I used to do. I thought that was my future, that I would never work again, that I would never get the opportunity to do all the things that I dreamed of, that this was my life now. And I had to be okay with that, because that was my present moment. And if that was all it was going to be, how was I going to choose to live my life in that present moment? Well, I'm going to be me. I'm going to be the giving, kind, generous, grateful person that I am, right? I had to decide. So those external things don't matter as much as who you think you are. And are you going to be the same person? The beautiful part for me was that it did get to shift, right? Mm-hmm. And now I'm teaching yoga, and now I'm running again, and I'm working, and I'm doing all of the things that I kind of wanted to do again, but it's in a very, very different way, right? It's so much more mindful, and it's so much more with the awareness that your fears might come true.
Yeah.
They did for me. I lost everything. But something beautiful came out of that. That I love and accept myself now.
Got it.
And I can look any fear head on now and go, I see you, but you're not more powerful than me.
Now, down to that question, do you have, like, what is your greatest fear in life right now?
My greatest fear has always been, like, I am such a connection person. I love humans. I love relationship. And being alone, like, is really hard for me. I've learned how to do it. I spent a very long time alone. And I had to do that in order to come to a place of wholeness within myself. But that's always been the fear that kind of haunts me sometimes. It's like, I don't want to die alone. I don't want to feel disconnected. And I think that's the biggest piece, is feeling disconnected, like feeling like I'm an island and I'm isolated and I'm alone. And it's something that I choose to face head on every single time. It rears its head, right? I think everybody has something that maybe will never go away. It's your opportunity, right? To grow. And so whenever it rears its head, I'm like, I see you. I'm choosing to connect. Like, I'm choosing to say, you know what? I'm not just waiting for things to happen. I'm choosing to make the life that I want, which is connection, which is being intimate with people, which is relating to people and making any relationship in my life better if I can.
Yeah. And to an extent, do you think that when you shift your energy and focus, like, in the moment, to live life in the moment, do you think that has kind of hasn't helped you in a way? Because the reason I ask this question is most people fear a lot of things. For example, overweight people might not want to go to the gym, and all of a sudden they're feeling isolated. You know what I mean? Like, a lot of people fear a lot of things, and it could lead to, like, anxiety, depression, aggression, addiction, so many things. Like, some of these things we fear that holds us back can manifest to a whole lot of other things that are really, really bad for us. So to tie that question down to the point you just made now, is it always good to face our fears, like, head on, rather than fear the fear?
I believe so. But it's not an energy of aggression, of like, I see you fear and I'm gonna conquer you.
Mm-hmm.
It's just being present. So whenever I teach yoga, this is the thing I always go back to every single class with every single student, is how do you feel right now? Ground. It's called grounding. Bringing yourself back into this moment. Don't worry about what's happened the last day. Don't worry about what's going to happen. It's literally this moment. Just that act alone takes away probably 95% of fears. Just doing that. Because if you're truly living in this moment, there's no room for the other fears. Because most of our fears are stuff you did in the past or future.
Yeah.
So that gets rid of a lot of them. Then everybody has their kind of one or two fears, like me, that are always in the present moment too. And so then you have a choice. Well, what's the ultimate truth? So what if your fear comes true? What if you are alone? Well, I was alone for a really long time. I felt very isolated and very, I wasn't seen, I wasn't heard. I felt very disconnected. So what's the truth? Well, I felt it. But does that mean I'm less of a human being? No. And I survived. So you get a choice to like see your fear head on and go, okay. Maybe it partially comes true, or maybe it's just my perspective of it coming true, right? Because I think that's where a lot of fears come from, is just our perspectives,
yeah.
Right? We think something's happening a certain way, or that we're being perceived a certain way, or whatever. But you don't ultimately know.
Yeah. Okay. I'm just going to try to like wrap this up very soon with one final question. There is this word called acclimation. Acclimation means repeated exposure to similar situations, which leads to like familiarity. Do you think that could help us with overcoming fear, when what you fear, you have been exposed to that often? Can that really help? Let's say the idea of, I don't want to eat healthy, I don't want to go to the gym, but have you actually tried? People give up so easily. What made you give up? Maybe it didn't work out the first time. Maybe you didn't do it right. Do you think that could help with encouraging people to like overcome their fears of what they don't believe in?
Yes, but not in the sense of like experiencing your fear helps you get over it. It's in the sense that you get to choose your life.
Mm-hmm.
We're creatures of habit.
Yeah.
So we talked about conditioning. So until you stop and think about who you are as a person, we just all kind of live and float around and like let things happen without realizing that it's actually because of habits. So we were born and we're taught all these certain things. And we just kind of function within these like, kind of like pre-programming, like on a computer. Right? We function in these things without realizing that you can actually change the programming. So that's where making small decisions in your day. Let's see, I'm going to try to pull an example from my life. Well, a recent one I did was, I hate waking up early.
Yeah.
But my whole life I was told that I was lazy and wouldn't amount to anything if I didn't get up early. So I'd get up early, but then I would hate my day because I was tired. And I realized, like, I get to choose that. I get to choose my habits. I get to choose how I want to feel. So I stopped doing that. Like, if I want to wake up at 8 or whatever, sleep in a little bit, I get to choose that. And if I want to wake up early, I get to choose that.
So you have the ability to, like, let's say, in a work system, you have the ability to choose the type of work you want that would allow you to live the type of life you want, per se.
Exactly. And just by changing those habits, then you, again, it's empowering, because you're like, look, like I made this choice and now it's affecting me this way and that feels good. So you start with those small things, and then it gives you, like, it empowers you, makes you feel stronger so you can do bigger things. Like maybe ultimately changing a job or whatever, right?
Yeah. All right. I really, really appreciate you taking the time to share your experiences and, you know, the way you've tried as in to overcome as in your fears in life. Definitely, I'm going to try to bring you back on a different concept. I believe it's also huge, the concept of as in belief. It's something we can talk about at some point in time, like to be able to like know how you've been able to like use that, you know, to improve your life to the way it is right now. And again, thank you very much for sharing us in your journey with us. I appreciate it.